read from verse 22. We began to consider verse 22 last week. Paul writes in Romans 7 from verse 22, "For I delight in the law of God in my inner being, but I see in my members another law waging war against the law of my mind and making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. I see in my members another law waging war against the law of my mind." It is perhaps groaning and thinking, when is it that we're going to get out of chapter 7? When is it that Alan's going to finish chapter 7? Well, it is that I personally have also wanted to finish chapter 7, but it is in terms of preparation I've discovered that really is that there is a wealth of teaching here for us. And I think not just from a theological perspective, but particularly from a pastoral perspective. And when it is that we perhaps be having doubts and so on concerning our eternal standing and our understanding of what it means to be in Christ. Now it is that the number that I want to bring before you today is the number 187 million. And that number 187 million is an estimate of the total number of deaths that were caused by war during the 20th century. Now it is that the 20th century is a century that was marked by great advancement and great change. I think in terms of my late grandmother, and it was that in her early days, men couldn't fly, there wasn't the radio, there wasn't even such thing as the motor car, and yet by the end of her life, when she was 94, near the end of the 20th century, it is that not only could men fly, they'd been to the moon, there was a space shuttle, there had been two major world wars, there were cars, and it is that for that generation, it must have seemed in some ways like a dream. When you look back to their days as children, and now what it was that they saw in terms of their environment and their lifestyle. But one of the things that I think we tend to forget that characterised the 20th century, above all other things, is that military conflict, war took place in every single year of the 20th century. So in other words, for 100 years, every year, in various parts of the world, it is that you would find theatres of war. It seemed to be the case that historians tell us that there were only short periods, even within a year, when it is that the world at large was free from war. And it is that we know that even within the first two decades of the 21st century, it looks as though things will be no better. Now it is that you may be saying, why are you beginning like this morning? What is war and the fact that war was every year in the 20th century, what has it got to do with us today? Well, I think it's got plenty to do with us. Look at our text. In verse 22, Paul says, "For I delight in the law of God in my inner being." And then he goes on in 23, "But I see in my members another law waging war against the law of my mind." And it is that Paul is reminding us that for the Christian, the person who has repented of their sins, who is trusting Christ for this life and for eternity, the Christian is someone who daily finds himself within a theater of war. In fact, not only do they find themselves within a theater of war, but they, even within their very being in terms of what they are as an individual, it is that they themselves are that theater of war. That within the lives of each one of us who are believers today, it is that we know in different degrees, in different times, and for different lengths, something of a state of war within our hearts and against our minds. And again it is that Paul says, "I see in my members another law waging war and seeking to make me captive." Now it is that we considered briefly last week how it is that Paul and how he gets to this point. You remember in verse 22, I said rather than verse 21, no verse 22 rather, my glasses are causing me problems. He says in verse 22, "I delight." That's the first thing that he speaks of here. He speaks of delight. And he speaks of delight in particular with reference to God's law. And it was that we took a little time trying to unpack what it is that he was teaching as to why it is that he delights in God's law. We saw that he delights in it because the law is like the one who gave the law. It's spiritual like God. It's holy like God. It's righteous like God. It's good like God. And he delights in the law of God because he, as a Christian, delights in God. So the law is like the one who gave it. Second thing that characterized his delight was, is that the law is holy and righteous and good because it is perfectly embodied in the person of Jesus Christ. In other words, the law is the very transcript of the character of Jesus. it is that when you would look to Jesus, you would see the physical embodiment of the Ten Commandments, all that characterized and is part and parcel of these ten good words. So it's a very transcript of the character of Jesus. So he delights in that law. And then the third thing we saw was that the law is holy and righteous and good because it is a description of heaven. What does it mean to be entirely like Jesus Christ? It means for you and me, as we are in Christ, to be the entire embodiment of the law. And so these are the reasons that I said we spent more time considering what Paul meant when he says that in his inner being, he delights in the law of God. The law is a thing to be prized. The law is a thing to be loved. The law is a thing to give God thanks for. But the second thing that we come to this morning, and in terms of our text, when he says in 20:23, I see in my members another law waging war. Not only does Paul speak about delight, but it is that Paul speaks about discernment. He's a discerning man. He's a man whose life has been changed. And when it is he discerns the nature of that change and what it means in terms of his walk with God, this is what he says, I discern, I see in my members another law waging war against the law of my mind and making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my bodies. You see, Paul is teaching us, and even as he's taught elsewhere, that a true believer feels an opposing law at work within his members. He's saying, I see another law. I discern it. I know that it's there. Now, that's the exact opposite to much of what is taught today. Today, often, it's the case that you're told when a sinner comes to Christ, it is that they will bid a final farewell to sin, and it is that they'll never sin anymore. It is that they can feel that they're already at the gate of heaven. But a little breath of temptation, and even falling to that temptation, they soon discover within themselves and cry out and say, I see another law. I discern another law. Now observe what it is that Paul calls this. He calls it another law. In other words, it's something that's quite a different law from the law of God, and it's a law that's clean contrary, the exact opposite, the antithesis of what it is that God's law speaks of and demands. Look at what he calls it, how he describes it there in verse 25, at the end of verse 25. He says, I serve the law of sin. It's a law that commands him to commit sin and that urges him on in terms of rewards and threatenings. Now consider what sin itself is. We've seen this in times past. Sin can be characterized as a missing of the mark. We've got a target, and we keep missing the target, missing the mark, because it in that sin makes our aim not as it should be. Sin means that we're not straight, that there's a bentness in our lives, that there's a curve in our lives. It doesn't measure up to the straight edge of God's law. It speaks about transgression. It speaks about slipping, when it is that we would slip and fall, because it is that we have been tempted and indeed know of that other law warning within ourselves. And so it is that we see how absolutely desperate and wicked this law of sin is and how we need to be aware of it. And then he also tells us that it's a law of sin and death. Look at what he says there at the end of verse 22. He says, I delight in the law of God in my inner being, but I see in my members another law waging war against the law of my mind and making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Who will deliver me from this body of death? In other words, it's a law that doesn't only lead to sin, but it leads to death. Physical death, spiritual death, eternal death. It's a law which in his letter to the Galatians is called the flesh. He says this, I say, walk by the Spirit, you'll not gratify the desires of the flesh, for the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh. For these are opposed to each other to keep you from doing the things that you want to do. And it's the same law that he speaks of when he writes to the church at Colossae, when he says, mortify, murder, put to death, therefore, what is earthly in you, sexual immorality, impurity, passion, evil desire, and covetousness, And then in verse 24, as God willing, we'll see next week, it's called in terms of this body of death. So what is this law of sin that he speaks of in 23? And notice where it is that he locates this law of sin. He says, it's in my members. It's in my flesh. In other words, this law is a power or an impulse, it's a principle that it's worked within the body of believers to make the individual believer be at war with themselves and to tempt to draw them toward that which is evil. It's virtually the same as what Paul calls elsewhere indwelling sin. So we can see that when we put all this together, that the law of sin that Paul speaks of here is the power and authority that sin has in Paul's body rather than any written law. It's not the old man. The old man, as we've seen, is dead. And there's the paradox. There's the thing that's startling. That it is that the new man, who even as he has this sinful flesh, that when he sins in Christo. He sins in Christ. And that's the way for each of us today. He continues with a holy rebellion against his own remaining sinful tendencies, and that's why it is that Paul says, you are a theatre of war. There's that battle that takes place increasingly and ongoingly every day. So in the heart of the believer, in the heart of those of us today who are Christians, there remains the whole members and body of the old nature. There remains the fountain of sin that has polluted this world and everything within this world. And notice that Paul says about this law. He says, I see my members another law. And notice he says what this law is doing. He says it's waging war. Now the term that Paul uses here is a military term. And it describes the struggle that takes place. He says it's waging war. And it takes me a captive. It makes me a prisoner. It is that in a sense the believer is a prisoner of war at times because of what it is that this law within his members seeks to do. Don't know if it is that, certainly growing up in the UK, one of the things that you came across fairly frequently growing up were the various war stories and tales of those who had been prisoners of war. You can think of a Colditz. And maybe it is, you can think of that movie from the 1960s with Steve McQueen, when it is that he sought to escape with him and others from Stalagluft 83. And it seems that Stalagluft 3, that what characterized this prisoner of war camp is that the inmates of that camp were inmates who had been able to escape from other camps. And so this was the high security one of its day. This was the one where all those who basically were able to flout the laws were sent to. And it is that it seems that the colonel, the head of the camp, Luftwaffe Colonel von Luger, this is a true story by the way, it is that when inmates would be sent to that camp, he would have them paraded outside, and one of the things that he would say to them, and repeatedly was, there will be no escape from this camp. There will be no escape from this camp. Well, the movie that Steve McQueen was in, it showed there was escape from the camp. And quite daring escapes and so on. And you see, Paul is saying to us here, when he uses this word, it's the Greek word for waging war. It means to line up troops. It means to go out on a military campaign. It's the word antistratio. And it's the word that we get our English word strategy from. And Paul is saying to us that indwelling sin, that it's constantly lining up, it's constantly seeking to make us prisoners of war, even of ourselves, it's constantly seeking to do battle with us, to pull us down, to destroy us, to discourage us, and to pull us away from God. He's saying, look, you've got to take on board as believers that evil is not only with us, but even in Christ. That evil is also waging war inside of us all the time. That leads me to say that all of us are going to struggle with sin as long as we're in this body of flesh, even though it is that we be new creatures in Christ. And it's saying to me that no amount of going to church, no amount of doing and saying that which we think will be pleasing to God will ever change that. You see, in Romans 7, and this is why it's so pastorally important, I see a most godly man, the best Christian, humanly speaking, who has ever and will ever live upon the face of this earth. And here is this godly man, and he's admitting the truth. And the truth is about the struggle within his own soul. And he's saying, I want you to know it's a war that's going on. You're in the midst of a battle. You just can't sit back. You just can't say, well, I'm a conscientious objector and I don't believe in war. Paul's saying, no, it cannot be. So if Paul struggled with sin, if Paul knew of this war, what do you think is going to happen to you and me as well? Do you know of that war today? We're going to struggle. And you know, as I know, that the real battles are not the ones on the outside. But the real battle of sin is in the inside. That place that nobody else ever sees. That struggle that goes on in your mind, in your heart, and in my heart, in my mind, between the pull of the flesh and the pull of the spirit. And the law in the members is not resting quiet. It's not calling a truce, but it's always fighting. It's always warring. There's peace with God, don't get me wrong. But there's a constant war with sin. And the army, the law and the members has got an army of lusts that he's able to take out and use against us any time that he wants. And it wages constant war against the law of God. How is it that perhaps some military unit, they end up being ambushed, takes them by surprise, and it is that they don't accomplish the mission that they were sent out on. And likewise for us, the lusts often lie quiet until the hour of temptation comes. And then it is that you start to fight and war against your soul. How do we apply that then this morning? Well, I think this. I think we need to recognize that one time and place that this battle is raging is every Sunday morning. One time and place that this battle is raging is every Sunday morning. We look a nice congregation. Well, I think we do. I hope you think you look nice as well. We look nice in church. We're cleaned up. We're dressed up. Some of us have our Sunday best on. But I know, you know as well, that behind every smiling face that's here, or every glum face that's here, there's a story of struggle. There's a story of heartache. There's a story of despair, of defeat, of victory, of cowardice, of bravery, fear and courage, all mixed up together. And though it is that we look very good when we come to church, and even we look very good one to another, the truth is if we could see our souls, it would be more appropriate to see us as a group of soldiers staggering out of the trenches that the soldiers were in during the First World War. Muddied, bloody, battered. Some of us limping, some of us with arms blown off, some of us having to be carried almost dead out of the trenches. Because that's what life is like. And I think for too long, we in our wing of the church have lost sight of that. And when it is that Christians fall and they fall, it is so often we stand up in judgment and go, tut, tut, tut. And we fail to recognize that they are the ones, perhaps, who have been in the battle hardest. And it is that there's been this almost nuclear onslaught against their souls by the principles of hell. No wonder it is that we fall and we just walk by and say, well, lie there. Save yourself. Some of us barely make it to church. Why? Because it's been a difficult week for us. A difficult week. Spiritually, emotionally, physically, in every way you've struggled over the last 7 days. And Paul says, there's a war going on. That's why You see, that's okay. It's okay to admit the truth. It's a struggle sometimes to come to church. And I've got to admit that. Because we'd all rather think, well, I look good, you look good, so I don't have any problems and you don't have any problems. The truth of the matter is that true healing, biblical healing, cannot begin until we can say to each other, there's a battle going on inside me. I've got to be honest with you, I was really struggling this week. And I didn't think I was going to make it. Do you see how important it is that we pray for one another? Do you see how important it is that we're nice to one another? That it is that we take on board what James says about the use of our tongues? I mean, it's bad enough if there's an enemy within us warring against us, but when it is that we get a brother or sister firing off at us with our tongue, that's even worse. You see, when people come to me as a pastor and say, Allan, I'm really struggling, and I know there's some people who will never come and say that to me. But when it is that people will come to me and say, and I've had them come to me and say, I'm really struggling on, I'm always encouraged that I can then direct them back to Romans 7 and to these verses and say, look, you're in good company. If you're really struggling, if you feel there's a war within you, you've got a lot in common with the greatest Christian who has ever lived. And that leads me on to this, that most of us are going to struggle with some particular sins for many, many, many years. But it's not going to be until we get to glory that it is that this war will finally be over. We're going to win some battles through Christ, and it is that we're going to win a lot of battles, but some of them will be very difficult. We're going to know significant amounts of victory. Remember, Romans 8 is just round the corner. There is therefore no condemnation now for those who are in Christ. But what I'm saying is, we're going to win some, we're going to lose some. We're going to be knocked down at times, and by God's grace, we're going to get back up. We're going to keep on struggling, and through the help of God, we're going to one day finally win the battle. But until that day comes, it is that we can't walk as we would want to. Even the best saints of God are going to struggle. You see, it's a verse like this that explains, that helps me explain and understand. Why is it that pastors fall? Perhaps some pastors fall from a great height. How else can you explain seemingly godly people doing things that make the hair in your neck stand up and end? How else can you explain Christian leaders and Sunday school teachers who will admit to heinous sins? How else do you explain the people of God saved who end up in jail? How do you explain God's people giving in to bitterness, anger, rage, gossip, jealousy, and all the rest of these things? The only way that I know how to explain it is the reality of indwelling sin and the struggle that we will all face in the war that's going on. I was reading in preparation for today about a farmer who I think illustrates very clearly what I've been trying to say. It seems this farmer, he was a hard man. He was hard on his employees, he was abusive to his animals, even his domestic animals, his dogs and his cats. He was really hard. It seems he had a foul mouth. And he used that foul mouth all the time. Every second word was a swear word, a curse word. It is that he had a vile mouth. But at some point, in accordance with God's grace, this farmer was converted to Jesus Christ. And it seems that after his conversion, there was a dramatic change. His language cleaned up. His behavior cleaned up. He became loving toward his wife and his family. He became fair and equitable with his employees. And it seems that he even treated the animals differently. But several months went by. And it seems that one day, months down the road after his conversion, he became angry and frustrated about something while he was working. And at that point, he began to fall back into his old patterns. He was cursing. He was dealing harshly with some of his employees. He was, in fact, even abusing the animals. But at one point, he caught himself in the midst of this, and it seems that he was absolutely crushed. And he ran out of the barn that he was in. And he made his way into his home, into the kitchen. He threw himself onto the kitchen table, and in front of his wife, he was convulsed with tears. His wife turned around and said to him, "What's the matter?" And he looked up, and through the tears, he barely said it, but he said, "I'm no different than I used to be. I'm no different than I used to be." And his wife smiled and looked at him and put her arm around him and said, "Oh, my dear, there's all the difference between you now and then. Then you would never have been sorry for what you'd done. Then you would never have thought that you'd done anything wrong. And you certainly wouldn't be contrite about what you had done. Oh, I see every sign that the Holy Spirit is working in you." It wasn't that he was perfect, but he knew it. But it's that he couldn't be happy in a state of rebellion against God. And he longed to be right with God, and when he wasn't right with God, he was miserable and he was wretched in it. And my friends, that's a sign of grace. That's a sign of the Spirit of God at work in your life. And this farmer illustrates the truth that the Christian life is characterized by struggle. So Paul is saying to us here in 23 when he says, "I see in my members another law waging war against the law of my mind and making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members." Paul basically is saying, Christians still sin, but Christians hate to sin. Christians still sin, but Christians hate to sin. In fact, the Christian believer longs to obey the law of God. And the true Christian believer finds out that the Christian life is characterized by a struggle. Now you say to me, "Well, Allan, that's all well and good. But you don't know what my sin has been like. You don't know what it is that I've said and done." Well, listen to this. In the deep wisdom of God, the law in the members of individuals does at times bring the soul into captivity. Think of the examples in Scripture. You've got Noah. He was a perfect man. He was a preacher of righteousness. He was a man who walked with God, and yet the war was raging, and Noah was led captive. Because what do we read? We read Noah drank of the wine and was drunk. And we know what ended up coming from that. Then you've got this preacher of righteousness. But for a moment, he was a prisoner of war. What about Abraham? Abraham, the friend of God. That's what God says about him. Can you imagine if it was said from the heavens today, "You're my friend"? Well, we are. But imagine if God picked you out individually today and made it clear to everybody, "This is my friend. And I'm friends with that one." Yeah, what did he do? He told a lie. He said to Pharaoh about his wife Sarah, "She's my sister." And we know what happened there. He went down the road a little while, and a little while later, he did the same thing again. He lied again and said the same thing. You thought he would have learned the first time. No. What about Job? Job, the perfect man. One day he feared God and hated evil. And yet, what does he end up doing? He's provoked to curse the day that he was. You ever felt like that? Wish you'd never been born. Sometimes that's the way it is. We've got to be honest about that. I wish you'd never been born. What about Moses? Moses had a bad temper. There's no doubt about it. He murdered a man. But it is, we can feel pity for Moses' frustration that he had with that stubborn and stiff-necked people. If it had been us, I think we would have done far more than Moses would have done. Temper. He suffered because he wasn't allowed in. You could see the land of promise, but he wasn't allowed to go in with the people. What about David? David sees this woman bathing. I think she was bathing deliberately so he could see her. And he commits
commits adultery. He gets the word, she's pregnant. So what does he do? Okay, her husband, I'm a bit murdered. I believe I'm a Christian. The war was raging. What about Peter? I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. And this slip of a lass in the courtyard. Because you're one of them. You're a Galilean. Your speech betrays you. It's like me when I go some places and they say, you're a Scotsman, your speech betrays you. It's the same for Peter. What does Peter do? I don't know the man. He starts swearing and cursing. You'd think he would have learned his lesson. Then Paul in Galatians tells us that when it was that Jews came to meet with Peter and others, that Peter, he ends up, because he's frightened, he ends up doing and saying what he shouldn't have done. All I'm saying to you is, have you experienced this warfare? Have you? There's nothing wrong with you if you have. Nothing at all. It's a clear mark of God's children that there is this war. And if any of you are groaning under this warfare, learn to be humbled by it and not discouraged. It's intended to make you lie in the dust. It's intended to make you realize that your only hope is Jesus Christ. That everything that you can bring before God is as filthy rags in His sight. And that, secondly, leads us on that it teaches us our need of Jesus. Oh, how we need Jesus. Oh, how we should be thankful every second of our lives for Jesus Christ. For who He is and what He has done. That as at the first, even until the end, you need the blood of Jesus as much as you did at the first. Why? Because not any one of you, nor me, can ever stand before God in our own strength. We just can't do it. Often and daily we have to go again and be washed in the blood of the Lamb and hide, as it were, under the wings of Jehovah, the Lord God, our righteousness. You must lean upon Him, even as I'm leaning in this pulpit at the moment, this lectern. Are you leaning on Christ? It's the only way that you can make it. And make it even in spite of this law of sin. Then, the third thing is, I think, saying to us, don't be discouraged. Don't be discouraged. Why? Because Jesus Christ is willing to be a saviour to such as you. Jesus Christ is still able to save you to the uttermost. Do you think your case is too bad for Christ to save? No. Everyone here whom Christ has saved had just such a heart as you here today. Listen to what Jonathan Edwards said in one of his resolutions. I quote, "Never to give over, nor in the least to slacken my fight with my corruptions, however unsuccessful I may be." In other words, Jonathan Edwards knew what Paul was speaking about here, and he puts it in a very practical way. Not in the least to slacken my fight with corruptions, however unsuccessful I may be. If Jonathan Edwards was unsuccessful, if Paul was unsuccessful, you and I are going to be unsuccessful. In these verses, Paul speaks of delight. He speaks of discernment. And then thirdly, he speaks of defeat. And he goes on from verse 24. Let's leave that then until next Lord's Day and see what he's saying to us when he says, "Wretched man that I am." That's a cry of defeat at that point. "Who will deliver me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ, our Lord." And that's the hope and the encouragement that we'll look at next Lord's Day. Amen.